add whatever you got, and let's just squeeze in toward the middle. Hey, Dale, can you help me out with some more monitor up here? But we're just going to take this time, this opportunity to pray together and seek the face of God, and we're going to go right into worship. But tonight, I'm telling you, you're going to get out of this service what you put into this service.
Yes.
If you come in here with no expectation at all, guess what? Don't expect to receive anything. But if you came in here with an expectation that God's going to meet you right where you're at, guess what? He's coming. And I want to tell you, we've been in a flow of the Holy Ghost for several months now. And I just feel like tonight could be a tipping point night. Come on, anybody want to go into what eye has not seen and ear has not heard? And I just feel that so strong. In the past several weeks, we've seen a broken foot healed. We've seen tumors vanish. Look, Thursday night in the prayer barn, I held up the needles and syringes in a bag of a drug addict who was delivered by the power of the Holy Ghost. We're not waiting on a move of God. We're in the move of God. Come on, anybody can testify. We're in the move of God. And tonight, if you've got cancer, you're going to leave here healed by the power of the Holy Ghost. If you come in here tonight sick in your body, you're going to leave healed by the power of the Holy Ghost. Lift up your hands. Father, we declare over this house, let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. Come on, lift up your voice and pray. Let your kingdom come, Lord. Let your will be done in this place as it is in heaven. Lord, we're believing for the realm of the miraculous to open up in this house tonight. God, we're believing tonight that the blind are going to see. Deaf ears are going to pop open. We believe for delivering power. We declare tonight that the opening of the prison doors to them that are bound. I just speak all over the nations of the world on the internet tonight. We rebuke every suicide spirit. We rebuke depression. We rebuke false religion. We pray for the fire of the Holy Ghost to come into your bedroom, to come into that I feel the Holy Ghost, to go into that hospital room. Wherever you're watching us, we declare that the anointing is tangible and transferable. We speak that families, marriages, oh hallelujah, are going to be restored tonight. We declare prodigals are coming back home in the name of Jesus. And I just declare freedom in this house. Freedom to worship, freedom to praise, freedom to worship God. I just declare over you the liberty that comes in the presence of Jesus. Come on, some of you are going to get your fire back tonight. I felt the Holy Ghost say, some of you are going to get your fire back tonight. I want every dancer, I want every worshiper, I want you to get out of your seat right now, and I want us to make an altar before the Lord here. Come on, where's my dancers? Where's my worshipers? Where's the people that want to pursue God's presence? Come on, get out from the house and get here. Come on. Holy Ghost, we want you tonight. Come on, stir it up. Holy Ghost, we need you tonight. We ask for revival. We ask for awakening. We ask for the power of God. We ask for demonstration. We ask for power. We ask for heaven to come. Come on, lift up your hands. Come on. Holy Ghost, we honor you in this house tonight. We're believing for the power to be revealed. Come on, I think we ought to lift up a praise right now. Come on. I believe we need to lift up our voices. Clap your hands and shout unto God with a... Woo! Come on. I said lift up your voice to the King of Kings. We worship you tonight. Come on. Come on. We worship you. Come on, let's worship tonight.
Come on, lift up your voice all over this room. Come on, shout unto God with a voice of triumph tonight. Hallelujah. We welcome your presence here tonight, Father. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. Come on, come on. Give him a praise. Give him a praise. Give him a shout. He's worthy. He's worthy. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. Come on, invade this atmosphere tonight. Invade this atmosphere. Invade our lives tonight. Oh. bless the Lord. Oh, mighty ones, bless the Lord, you heavenly hosts. Bless the Lord, oh, you his angels, and let all the earth sing forth his praises. Sing, bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh, mighty ones. Bless the Lord, you heavenly hosts. Oh, bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord,
oh, you his angels, and let all the earth. Come on, I want you to sing that again tonight. Oh, bless the Lord, oh, my God. Bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord.
Oh, bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord.
Oh, you his angels.
Oh, you his angels.
And let all the earth.
And let all the earth sing forth his praise.
Come on and bless him. Hey, hey.
Come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on and bless him.
Come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on and bless him. Come on and bless him. Come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on and bless him. Hey, hey, hey.
Come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on and bless him.
Bless the Lord, oh mighty one. Lift your voice. Bless the Lord, you heavenly hosts. Bless the Lord, oh. Bless the Lord, oh you his angels. And let all the earth.
Let all the earth.
Come on, sing it again. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord, oh mighty ones. Yes, bless the Lord, you heavenly host. Bless the Lord, oh.
Bless the Lord, oh you saints.
And let all the earth. Lift your voice, come on and bless him, say.
Come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on and bless him. Come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on and bless him.
Come on and bless him.
Come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on and bless him.
Come on, come on, come on, come on.
Come on and bless him.
Come on and bless him, say, say.
Come on and bless him.
Come on and praise his name.
Come on and bless him.
Come on and bless him.
Come on and praise his name.
Come on, one more time. Come on and bless him.
Come on and bless him.
Come on and praise his name.
Come on and bless him.
Come on, come on, come on.
Come on and bless him.
Come on and praise his name.
For the Lord delights in.
For the Lord delights in. Show me mercy.
For the Lord delights.
For the Lord delights in. Show me mercy.
Oh, for the Lord
delights. For the Lord delights in. Show me mercy.
For the Lord delights. Yes, he does.
For the Lord delights in. Show me mercy.
Come on, put your hands together all over this room. Come on. Everybody, put your hands together. Come on, are you excited to be in the house of God tonight? Come on, did you come expecting a move of God tonight? Come on, I said, did you really come expecting a move of God tonight? Come on, it's not about a preacher tonight. It's not about a singer. It's not about one of these musicians. It's for him tonight. Do you believe that? Come on. Come on, now it's time. We're gonna move around just a little bit. Everybody move around. Come on. Sitting in your seat up here, whatever. I want everybody moving around all over this room if you can. Oh!
take. When I move my body, when I move my feet, when I open my mouth, then the darkness flees. When I move my body, when I move my feet, when I open my mouth, then the darkness flees. When I move my body, come on.
When I move my feet,
when I open my mouth, then the dark, when I move,
when I move my body, when I move my feet,
when I move my body, when I move my feet, when I open my mouth, then the darkness flees. When I move my body, when I move my feet, when I open my mouth, then come on, come on. When I move my body, lift your voice,
hey, hey, hey,
then the darkness flees. Sing it again. Say, when I move my body, when I move my feet, when I open my mouth, then the darkness flees. When I move my body, when I move my feet, when I open my mouth, then the darkness flees. When I move my body, when I move my feet, when I open my mouth, then the darkness flees.
When I move my body, when I move my feet, when I open my mouth,
my praise is a weapon.
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 And my dance is a weapon.
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 You know, I think if you really... Hold on. I think if you really knew that your dance was a weapon, you wouldn't be standing there like this tonight. If you really knew that your dance could break strongholds over your life, you wouldn't be standing there tonight. If you really knew that your family could get saved over your dance, does anybody know what I'm talking about? I don't really think you do. Come on, come on, there's power in your praise. There's power in your dance. I want everybody to move around. Hey, hey, hey. Oh, yeah, yeah, yes. Say, my dance. Oh, my dance is a weapon.
My dance is a weapon.
My dance is a weapon.
My dance is
yes,
a weapon.
Yes, my dance is a weapon.
My dance is
oh,
a weapon.
My dance is a weapon. Sing it again.
My dance is
oh,
a weapon.
My dance is a weapon.
My dance is a
oh,
weapon.
My dance is a weapon.
My dance
oh,
is
yes,
a weapon.
My dance is a weapon.
My dance is a weapon.
My dance, sing my shout. Oh, my shout is a weapon.
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 My shout. Come on, somebody shout tonight. Come on, come on, come on. Hey, oh, yeah, yeah, yes. Come on, come on. Oh, now.
Come on, come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on, come on and bless him.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
Come on, come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on, come on and bless him.
Oh, come on, come on.
Come on, come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on, come on.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Say,
come on, come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on, come on.
When I move, say,
when I move my body, when I move my feet, when I open my mouth, then the darkness flees.
When I move my body, when I move my feet, when I open my mouth, then the darkness.
Oh, when I move my body,
when I move my feet, when I open my mouth, then the darkness flees. When I move my body, when I move my feet, when I open my mouth,
when I move, when I move,
when I move my body, when I move my feet.
come on, come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on, come on and bless him.
One more time, say,
come on, come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on, come on and bless him.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Come on, come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on, come on and bless him.
Tell somebody, give him a shout all over the room tonight. Come on, I feel something in the atmosphere stirring tonight. Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. My praise is a weapon.
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 Oh, my praise is a weapon.
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 My praise. My praise is a weapon.
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 Oh, hallelujah. Now somebody, why don't you just praise him? Why don't you just lift your hands and just tell him how good he is, how great he is, how awesome he is tonight. Oh, we love you, Father. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. Yes. Oh, come on, come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on and bless him. Come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on and bless him. Oh, yes. Come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on and bless him. Yes. Come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on and bless him. One more time, lift your voice. Come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on and bless him. Come on, yeah. Come on and bless him. Come on and praise his name. Come on and bless him. Oh,
on earth as it is.
your heart tonight. Lift your voice. Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the power. Yours is the glory forever. Amen. Yours, lift your voice.
Is the power, yours is the glory forever. Amen.
Yours
is the kingdom.
Yes, it is.
Is the power, yours is the glory forever. Amen.
Yours
is the kingdom.
Let heaven come.
Glory forever.
tonight. Release it over your people tonight. Come on, lift your hands all over this room. Come on, cry out for more. Cry out for more. Oh, heaven, kiss the face of the earth right here tonight. Yeah. Release it, release it, Lord.
Of mine says that expectancy is the breeding ground for miracles. And I told Mark, I said, there is such an expectancy of the Word of God and what's about to happen that we're gonna shift this earlier than we normally do, because I'm just sensing that the man of God has something for an impartation, and a lot of people have come in here tonight because you want more than just what you normally would receive in your Bible study and your home prayer group, and you're here for a purpose tonight. So let's lift our hands and let's do this. Let's get the level. Let's do two things. Number one is, don't preconceive what you want to hear. Don't preconceive what you want, but get your total expectancy level that God is going to pay you a visitation today. Get it up right now. Come on, raise your hands with me. Oh, God, we lift our hands together. And when we begin to expect, it's releasing our faith. Our faith is tied into our expectancy. The woman with the issue of blood expected to receive something when she touched Jesus. So tonight, I implore you, Heavenly Father, to do a special work. We believe as we get ready this week to go into the new year on God's calendar, and the trumpets are sounding in the next couple days, we believe that God is going to give us 12 months of a move of God that we've never had at OCI.
Woo!
Well, God, we believe a real revival, a stirring, changing revival is coming. We're praying for it for 3 years. We're not quitting. So God, do this today for us. And as we get moving in the service and we shift this service toward your word, just do whatever you wish to do in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen. Wow, wow, wow. You better shake a couple people's hands. You better slap somebody a high five or a low five and tell them that they are in the right place tonight. Cleveland, Tennessee, on a Tuesday night. We greet our worldwide internet audience right now, the OCI family audience around the world that's joined us for a great night of revival Tuesday night right here in Cleveland, Tennessee. Amen. And we're going to take a moment, let you find a seat if you can. Praise the Lord. All right. Good to have each of you here. And we have a lot of people standing around the wall. So when you're seated, once you're seated, we're going to get everybody comfortably seated in an area that wants a seat. And then we'll proceed with the service. So I need some ushers in the back to help me here. So Gary, if you and Ray and a couple of the guys will help the folks when we get our seats here. All right. Okay. Now, if you have a seat near you, if it's two seats, raise two fingers. If it's one seat, raise one. If it's three. Okay, everybody look. All right, all you folks in the back, I know you don't want to have to stand through the whole service. Come on down here, ushers, and find a seat. There's seats available for you. And just go ahead and do that right now if you'd like. I see nobody moving. I guess they're holding up the wall for us. Yeah, we can go ahead and dismiss the kids now. If the kids group wants to go ahead and be dismissed, that'll give us a few seats too. So go ahead, kids, and be dismissed. We usually do that at the offering time, but you can do that right now. So all of our children's ministry that's available in the children's ministry, amen. We just want to make sure everybody that wants, some folks may be standing up to get out in case the Holy Ghost hits real heavy. You know, that can happen too, so. Amen. We're so glad to have you. As you know that Mark felt impressed of the Lord to call this entire month of September to remember. And I'm telling you, I wish you could have been in the prayer barn. We had the greatest prayer meeting in the prayer barn in the history of the prayer barn Thursday night. It was the greatest supernatural move of God that we've ever had. And this Thursday night, of course, we'll be there as well. We want to invite you to participate in that because God is, man, he's just moving in a tremendous way. We had testimonies coming in of miracles taking place. And this has truly been a time that's been set aside for that. We've got some great things coming up in the month of October. I have not preached here. I can't tell you how long it's been. I think it's been 2 months or longer. So next week you get me. Hallelujah. I'm going to be here preaching on Tuesday night next week. And I don't do that often, but the Lord has really given me a word I'm excited about, and we're going to have either a fire tunnel next Tuesday night, or we're going to pray for everybody that needs the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Now, if you've never been around that, you need to come and have an encounter with the Holy Spirit. This is going to be encounter of the Holy Spirit night. I'm telling you, I feel it building up in my spirit. If you're interested, tomorrow night, I'll be at Abba's house for their conference, and we're going to be ministering there. If you want to drive down, Mark and I'll be there, and I'll be preaching tomorrow night on how to prophesy against the lie. So we're going to have a word there as well. Well, we thank you for coming. How many of you, we got some partners all the way from Alabama here. A whole row of them. Oh, glory to God. Stand up, Neil and Shelley. Stand up. This couple here has known me longer than my wife has. How do you like that? And back when I was a debonair, handsome, black-haired preacher. I'm just kidding. Good to have them here. Welcome them all the way from Alabama. It's so good to have them here, partners of our ministry. Now, if you're a first-time visitor, here's what we'd like to do. We have some greeters that are handing you a card. If you'll take a card and fill it out, hold on to it at the end of service. We're going to go back into the dance room tonight. Now, you're not going to have to dance, nothing like that. But we had to shift the rooms. We're going to go right back here, and we're going to greet you and give you a gift and share with you just about 5 minutes. So if you're a first-time guest here, raise your hand, and we'll give you a card, and you can fill it out. We always want to meet the people that come for the first time and greet you and just welcome you. Love on you a little bit. Let us know how much we love and appreciate the people of God and those who are coming into the kingdom of God in these last days. Amen. How many of you know, I'm going to go ahead and say this, what happens coming up in a short time? My. October 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th, and 11th. We're going to, say it real loud. Main event. Right over in the big hall is our main event. 9 services Tuesday night through Saturday evening. 4 morning services. Brian Cutshaw, Kevin Wallace, Mark Casto, and a preacher. He's not that well known, but we're getting tons of calls. When's he preaching? His name is Jensen Franklin. And so, yeah, you know him. He's going to be here. He doesn't preach that much conferences, but when I ask him to come, he's always wanted to come and be with us. And has he preached in the new hall yet? He's not been here with this one. He can't wait to get here. I know that. But we're going to have a great time. It's open to the public. Our Tuesday night service on the 7th of October will not be in this room. We will move everybody, the OCI family, over to the big room. This is not a partners conference. This one is open to everybody that wants to come. And guess what else is happening that week? Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. None other than Mama P. Home cooking. Fried pie. pie, chicken dinner, Fall Festival. Somebody give a hand for Mama P's Fall Festival. Second year in a row. I know she's excited. Now, Thursday afternoon, there's going to be a tag team preacher mania. Friday afternoon, there's a gospel singing. And Saturday, we have a what's called a couples game contest. And we are going to have so much fun. I've got some sneaky plans of my own that day. And we're going to be giving awards away to the couples who know each other more than they thought they did. And it's going to be like the dating game, the newlywed game, plus a lot of other crazy games we're going to be playing. And you're going to get to watch people either make a total fool of themselves in front of everybody. It's going to be fun, okay? So we want to invite everybody here and those watching to join us for the great main event. Going to be a wonderful time in the Lord. Now, how many of you know that right now we're still in Teshuvah, but do you know what's about to happen this week? We're coming into that great festival called the Feast of Trumpets, which represents the coming of the Lord for the church. You've given a great Teshuvah offering, and if you have a tithe offering tonight, mark it as tithe, or if it's a Teshuvah offering, you can do that. But I want you to listen to me very carefully. We have tonight a man who has been honored and blessed of God to head up two of the greatest revivals in modern time. And I know you've heard about the Pensacola revival and also the Brownsville revival. And he is a revelator of God's word. He's a revivalist. He's an apostle. He's a spiritual father to a generation. There's so much that you could say. Now, there is a verse in the Bible, and everybody pay attention because we're going to give him an offering tonight, what comes in, okay? But listen to me carefully. When you give, according to Jesus, to a prophet, you receive a prophet's reward. Now, what is a prophet? A prophet is someone who speaks under divine inspiration. And what they speak and predict happens because they are hearing from God. Now, how many of you would like all those promises that you got in your journal? I'm talking to somebody now. All those things you believe God has showed you to suddenly begin to manifest. And now you don't have to wait any longer. You can believe for it. Well, can I tell you, when we bring in a man like John Kilpatrick, who has seen the wondrous works of God, the miracles of God, the move of the Spirit, the actual glory of God that has come down in his buildings and places where he's been, I want to sow into that work. Here's why. Because if I sow to him, that I am believing of putting a demand on that revival anointing, hey, that glorious move of the Spirit that will come into my life. Now, we walk in a level of that, but I happen to know that when we give as OCI, I just felt that. If we'll give to this man who has experienced revival, what we help him to do, God's going to send revival right here to OCI. I'm talking about Brownsville went on 7 years, guys, 7 years with Steve Hill, and I believe it can happen. So here's what I want you to do. You don't hear me do this often. Everybody get an offering for the man of God's work, for his ministry. You can make out the check to OCI. I promise you that if you designate it as tithe, it'll go to the house. But outside of that, I promise you we will give this man probably not only what comes in, hopefully can make some of it up as well and just give him an offering. I want him to leave here saying that is a place that God's hand is on. And I want him to leave here saying they are a blessed people. Many of you, when you start coming here, I remember you. You didn't have jobs. You couldn't find jobs. But when you start coming here, the favor of God that's on the ministry began to come into your life. And next thing I knew, bam, you had a job. Over here, you had an increase. Bam, God gave you something else. And now, a large majority of our people have jobs. And not just jobs, but good jobs. That come on, somebody, help me praise God if you know what I'm talking about. And so you have been blessed, and you're going to continue to be. Now, get your offering ready. Again, you can make it out to OCI. We will see. We will make one check to his ministry. So let's give right now. Everybody got something in your hand. This is Pastor, this is a giving group of people. And we don't say a lot about it, but they are so into the Word that they know what the Word teaches. And this is a group of people. I'm telling you, they act on the Word of God. They really do. Let's pray over your gift. Father, we thank you tonight for all you're doing. We thank you for every visitor, every guest that's here, and the OCI family. It's going to be a great night in the Lord. So bless the offering and use it for the kingdom of God. Use it for the ministry, for the building that He is building. God, You helped us build debt free. Help Him build debt free in Jesus' name. I pray. And everybody said amen. All right. We bring the offerings. If you've never been here before, we have offering containers. We'd love for you to march it up and just bring it. And just as you're bringing it, say, God, give me that revival anointing. Lord, give me that glory of God in my life as well. We're going to sow this for that reason. Yes, Lord, we sow this, God, tonight, believing that OCI in the time to come will experience a great, great outpouring of the Spirit, a great, great move of God, a great demonstration of the Holy Ghost, a great demonstration of God's power. God, we're believing tonight that it's going to be so. We're believing that as we give, Heavenly Father, we're still in the seasons of God, that blessing, favor, and life is going to come. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus. Anybody that needs a job, I mean, if you're serious, you say, Perry, if God gave me a good job, I'd work hard at it. If you need a job, put your hand up and hold it up. In fact, just keep your hand up if you need a job. Hold it up. Hold it up. Hold it up. Okay, we've got about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Got 6, 7. Now, can you believe that? Out of this crowd, just 17 people need jobs. That tells you the blessing of God, don't it? All right, keep your hand raised. Keep your hand raised. Here we go. Father, in the name of Jesus, I come to You right now. Mark and I both have an anointing. We don't say that bragging, God, but it came from You. And we know it's there. We recognize it. An anointing of being debt-free and an anointing for jobs, to pray for people that need jobs. Tonight, the 17 people that raised their hands, I'm making a decree. Many of them, God, I see them in the offering line. So, because they've obeyed You tonight, give all 17 of these a job in the next 30 days. Let them come and testify to us, Heavenly Father, of what You have done. We'll give You the glory and honor. And God, not just any job, not a second-hand job, third-hand job, but a good one that'll help them to be able to use whatever ability and woo, hallelujah, ability and giftings they have. In Jesus' name I pray. How many of you believe it? Say, I believe it. Come on. Watch it. Watch and see. I'll stand up here and tell you about it in 30 days. Watch and see. Hallelujah. They're still coming. I told you, Pastor, they're a giving group here. Don't you love people that just believe the Word? Amen. So we've dismissed the children. Huh? We've dismissed the children. We're about ready to go. I'm going to ask, and I'll take just a moment here and let them fit complete, but Pastor Mark is going to take just a moment and share with you the reason he's asked Brother Kilpatrick to come. He came to me and said, I felt like we need John Kilpatrick to come. I called him on the phone, and oddly enough, he understands this. This is rare. This date was open, and it normally wouldn't be. So we knew it was the Lord. And so if you've noticed, God's been building up. If you've been here every Tuesday night, God's been building up through Pastor Mark about miracles. We're seeing miracles. Y'all know we've had 2 people healed of cancer. Somebody give the Lord praise. And that's not counting. That's not counting all these other miracles. And now we're moving into another dimension. Next week, we're going to move into a real... Now, look, I have a feeling, Pam. I got a feeling next week it's going to be Perry Stone Unleashed. You might see the old Perry from 30 years ago. Now, if you do... Well, just... He said, I dare you, Mark did. I just feel like we're going to have a really heavy move of the Spirit. It's going to be wild around here. It's going to be crazy. So you need to come and experience God. Amen. Pastor Mark, I think we're about finished. If you'll come at this time. Yes. Oh, I'm sorry. Watch the announcements. We're going to have some announcements, and then we'll go from there. Go ahead and start those, guys, if you'd like.
Hey, I'm Kevin Mitchell.
And I'm Barbara Mitchell.
And we're here to give you
FYI at OCI. September, a time to remember. Next Tuesday, on the 30th, is our final service. Can you believe it? Papa P will be the speaker. Make sure you're here.
Small groups are back in session, and they begin 6:30 every Monday night. These include Men's Small Group with Ray Tapp, Book of Acts with Ricky Scaparo, and last but not least, Overcomers with Kevin Mitchell. Small groups are still taking members. All you have to do is show up. And on September 26th, we have our Friday night encounter. Evan Kilpatrick will be speaking, and it begins at 6:45.
September 27th is nursery training. It's going to be in the hospitality room at 10 a.m. This is for everyone who is currently working in the nursery. And if maybe you're looking for a place to plug in, why not plug in there? We really need you.
Finally, on September 28th, Hope House is having their graduation ceremony. Everyone is invited to attend, but we please ask that you sign up at the information table. If you do plan on attending, it begins at 3 p.m. Once again, we're the Mitchells.
And this has been FYI at OCI.
FYI at OCI, what about that? You came up with that. It's a gift. Use it or lose it, Mark. It's a gift. I want to. Mark is going to share a word about tonight, why John Kilpatrick is here. But let me say something that he was telling us about his testimony of being called into the ministry. The man from the time of 14 has walked in actually the supernatural presence of God throughout his life. And God is real. And we want to bring people in to minister here that can make God real to us. We can preach sermons all day long. There's great preachers, but there's not enough preachers that have had experiences with God. Okay, they know theology, but the experience is missing. So I want to, as the sort of like the papa of the house, I want to first welcome him and greet him before Mark comes. It's good to have we call him our Archbishop Dennis McGuire of OCI, and I say that in sincerity. He's over Mark and I. He's our spiritual dad to make sure that we stay in order. Amen. How many know Dennis McGuire can rebuke you if you're out of order? Say amen. And he cracked me up. I went to London with him, and we were sitting there. I didn't know you could do this. I'm just done with technology. We are in Birmingham, England, in a hotel. He says, watch this. And he goes on his iPod and gets a Tennessee preacher that's preaching on the internet. Then he says, I'll show you something wild, and you can do this. He tapped into the Bradley County Police Department scanners in Birmingham, England. And I heard one of the policemen say, OCI. And I went, what? Remember that? I said, he just said OCI. I'm serious, man. And I'm like, oh, this is wonderful. but anyway, good to have him here today. Mark, if you'll come and greet and just share, and we're going to turn you loose. And Brother Kilpatrick, our people love preaching. They love stories, but they love the presence. And you just do whatever you want. You're with us just one service, and I promise you this bunch will stay till it's over. How many know what I'm talking about? You're hungry people. God bless you for being here. And don't forget next Tuesday as well.
I also want to say we got a general in the house tonight. The great Dr. T.L. Lowry is in the house tonight. Come on, let's honor the man of God who's paved the way for a generation to know the power of God, to experience the miracles of God, and we're thankful to have him here. You know, the devil tried to take him out 3 times in the past year and a half, but he couldn't do it. And I told Perry, I said, let's go see him. There was a day we were doing something. I said, let's just ride over there and see him. And we got over there and we were going to check on him. He said, how are you doing, doctor? I said, I'm doing good. And all of a sudden that fist came up like this. And he said, I'm going to preach this weekend. And 85 years old, preaching the gospel. Yeah, yeah. So it's awesome. I had the honor and privilege of serving under Dr. Lowry's ministry and being able to go through his videos and pictures and things. And I'll never forget this one time. I was going through the old tent pictures, and there was a picture of Dr. Lowry and a man, and they both had sawdust up and down their back. And I said, Dr. Lowry, what happened? He said, Mark, he said, I laid hands on him. Power of God was so strong, we both fell out and then got up and shouted. So I'm praying for some of that to hit this place tonight. I just want to share this just real brief to give him time to minister, but I want you to understand the moment that we're stepping into. Back in the beginning of August, I was in the secret place talking to God, and I said, Lord, what is it that you want to do in this season as we prepare for Teshuvah? And the Lord took me into a 3-hour encounter where I saw a beautiful tree And underneath the tree, I saw the root system of the tree. I said, Lord, this is a beautiful tree. But all of a sudden, he went to the root system. And underneath the root system, there were three demonic spirits that were working against the roots. It was disappointment, discouragement. Those things that were coming against doubt, discouragement, and disappointment that were working against the root system. And I said, Lord, why are you showing me this? And he said, because everything looks good on top. Everything looks good right now on top, but he said, underneath in the root system were severe devastation. How many knows that the tree can look nice on the outside, but if the root system, it won't take long that if the root system gets destroyed, the whole tree gets destroyed. And I said, Lord, what do you want me to do? And he said, I want you to begin to prophesy over the tree and for life to come back and for the roots to be restored. And as I'm doing that, I hear the Lord say, and the month of September will be a time to remember. And he said that so strong. And he said, Mark, I want you to designate every Tuesday night in the month of September to just telling the old stories. And I said, okay, God, I'm excited about that. So then I went to Cincinnati and preached a meeting with Dutch Sheets and Lou Engel. And while I was there, they shared with me a dream that was given by an intercessor in Kansas City. And this vision was about a girl, and she saw a bunch of people laid out with seven ambulances all over. And all of a sudden said, what are these people that are laying here? He said, it's the intercessors. Have you heard this, Pastor Kilpatrick? He said, here's the intercessors. And there were attendants going through checking for pulses. And those attendants were the angels of God. And they said, we're looking for a pulse. We can't find any. And all of a sudden, one of the angels said, I found one. He said, well, what did you do to get a pulse? And the angel turned around and said, tell the old stories. Tell the old stories. And that angel turned around to that girl and said, you go back and you tell the preachers to tell the old stories. That it's a time to remember. And that's when I said, Lord, I believe I'm hearing from you. I believe you got an assignment on this month. And so we begin to share those things with you. And I said, Lord, what do you want done? And he said, I want you to call Pastor John Kilpatrick. Because if anyone has stories, he's got the stories. If anyone's seen what we're believing for, he's seen it. And I just believe tonight is a night that as he shares the stories, as Revelation 19 says, the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. And tonight when he shares those testimonies, we're not just shouting about what God did. We're shouting because what God did is what he's about to do in this room tonight. So I want you to stand on your feet. I want you to welcome a father and a general to this generation. I want you to welcome Pastor John Kilpatrick to OCI tonight.
Thank you very much. Thank you. You may be seated. Thank you very much. Wow, it's so good to be here. I want to thank Mark and especially Perry Stone for having me come. Perry Stone and Till Lowry are absolutely two of my greatest heroes. They are the standard bearers of our generation for Pentecost. And I love them dearly. And I'm honored to be in the same room with both of them at the same time. I thank you for being here tonight. I want the opportunity to just sort of speak into your life. There's a lot of ways that I could go, but I want to just talk about the presence of God. I want to talk about a move of God. There's nothing in the world like revival. Let me tell you something. I don't know about you, but I'm tired, sick and tired of church as usual. Come on, help me. I'm tired of church as usual. After you have ever had your feet under the table of revival, no other table will ever satisfy you. Because revival is not church as usual. Revival is a spontaneous combustion of prayer that has been locked up in a place after the saints have prayed. We prayed 2.5 years for revival at Brownsville. And I have to be honest with you and tell you, before revival broke out, we had started praying for 2.5 years, and as soon as we started praying for revival, it felt like it was going to happen any minute. And then we prayed 2.5 years, and right as revival was about to break out, I didn't know it, it felt like it would never break out. Matter of fact, I was so discouraged, I was really ready to leave Brownsville. I was just tremendously discouraged. So here's the moral of the story. If you're praying about something and it feels like it's about to happen, it's probably not. If you're praying about something and it feels like it'll never happen, it's right at the door. Come on. That's exactly right. There's a scripture that I want to read just to get started tonight. I'm going to just talk out of my heart. I'm going to tell you stories as the Lord gives them to me. I'll get a flow going here, but I'm not going to go with any notes or anything like that. But I do want to read one passage of scripture. If you've got it in your Bible, if you got your Bibles, I want you to read with me in Deuteronomy chapter number 6. And I want to read verse 7, and then I want to read verses 20 through 22. Verses 6 and 7. If you have it on the screen, you can get it on the screen for me. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 6 and 7. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thine heart. Thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. And then in verse 20, the Lord said, when your son asks you in time to come, saying, what means these testimonies and these statutes and the judgments which the Lord our God has commanded you? You shall say unto your son, we were in Pharaoh's bondmen in Egypt, and the Lord brought us out with a mighty hand. The Lord showed us signs and wonders, great and sore, upon Egypt, upon Pharaoh, and upon all of his household before our eyes. So I think today one of the things that's missing in Pentecostal circles, especially charismatic circles, is we are siring up a generation that has never really had a power encounter with God. You know, Perry said a while ago when he was introducing me, he said, from the age of 14, you know, I began to have supernatural things happen in my life. I'm going to take you back just for a minute, and I want to talk to you about that period of time, and I'm going to lead up to Brownsville Revival, and I'm going to lead up to the present day. What I'm about to tell you is probably the most important thing that's ever happened to me in my life, besides being saved, filled with the Holy Spirit, being married, and having children. This is probably the greatest thing that ever happened in my life. So it's going to take me a while to get there, but I have to sort of set the stage for you to understand where I'm going. My mother got saved when I was about 6 years old. When I was five, my mother had been married before, and she had three daughters. I have three stepsisters, and my father had been married, and my mother was his seventh wife, and she didn't know it. She was his fifth wife. She didn't know it, and he was married seven times, two more times after her. So my father really, I believe, and I say this respectfully, but I believe he was demonized. He had a lot of good traits. He was an extremely handsome man. He was a womanizer, and he married my mother, and whenever my mother got saved, my sister started dating an Assembly of God evangelist. And he and his two brothers were 10 evangelists, and they traveled America. And whenever my sister married this evangelist and he came into our family, my sisters got saved and filled with the Holy Spirit. I still remember the night that my sisters got the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I used to have to sleep in the bed with them. And I remember they spoke in tongues all night long. I couldn't get a bit of sleep. And I slept at the foot of the bed, and their feet was in my nose all night long. And they was jerking and shaking all night, speaking in tongues, even in their sleep. And the next day, on Thursday, after they got the Holy Spirit on Wednesday night, on Thursday, my youngest sister at that time couldn't even speak in English all day long. All she could do when she'd open her mouth was speak in tongues. So I saw the presence of God early in my life. I was about five. But whenever I was six, my mother got saved. And when she got saved, my father turned against her. He didn't want a Christian wife. And he certainly didn't want a tongue-talking Christian wife. So when my mother got saved and she wanted to go to church, my father became very abusive. And it was all over church. It was all over Pentecost. So when my mother started going to church, my dad wouldn't let me go. I was his only child out of seven marriages. And so he didn't want me to be a part of tongue talking, and he didn't want me to be a part of, you know, that kind of stuff. He called it devil stuff and demonic stuff. So he kept me at home with him. But I saw and I felt when I was around my mother when she got saved, I could tell that something powerful had happened in her life. So finally my mother said to him one day, she said, J.C., she said, I love you and I'll never be disrespectful to you. But she said, I don't want to go to hell. And she said, I don't want my daughters to go to hell and I don't want our son to go to hell. She said, I beg you, let me take him to church. So he relented, but whenever he did, he became violent. So we'd ride the bus to church. He had a car in the driveway. He could drive us, but we had to catch the city bus to church, get off and transfer, and then get off and walk after transferring twice to that Assembly of God church. After church, walk back to the bus stop, catch the bus, transfer, get another bus, get off the bus stop, walk home. The mother would have to cook lunch on Sunday. Well, whenever she'd start cooking, my father would set in and he'd start cussing her. He'd start mocking, speaking in tongues. And he would just be very violent. And he wouldn't usually stop till he drew blood out of her nose or her mouth. And I saw that almost on a weekly basis. So I saw early the price that my mother paid for me to be able to be in church. And I remember seeing the blood. And I remember I used to say, boy, there's got to be something to this for Mama to have to go through this every week taking me to church. So anyway, that was from the time I was 8 until I was 12. When I was 12, my father left, and he went off with another woman, and he left my mother. My mother only had a third grade education. So whenever he left, she had to get a job in a nursing home scrubbing floors on her hands and knees. That was back really before the days of the electric scrubbers and all that. So she scrubbed floors in a nursing home, and that's how we survived. And he gave $15 a week child support, and we were very, very poor. We suffered after my father left in a great way. So whenever my mother began to work at the nursing home, from the age of 12 until I was 14, I wasn't suicidal, but I had lost the will to live. I had seen so much. I had seen my mother go through so much, and it was all over church and the Holy Spirit, that I was bewildered. I was not doubting Pentecost, or I wasn't doubting the power of God. I'd just seen so much, I was just weary with it. And I didn't have any interest in sports. I had no interest in girls. I was just sort of numb. And then we started going to my brother-in-law's father's church. And when we started going to his church, they had a youth group there. And I started going some to the youth group. And I saw young people praying and receiving the Holy Spirit. And I couldn't receive. I tried and sought God. I couldn't receive it to save my life. And I asked God, I said, Lord, I really earnestly seek you, but I can't feel anything. I can't receive. I see other young people come in here for the very first time. They just pray through and get the baptism. I said, Lord, I believe in it, and I believe that it's real, but I'm not going to fake it. I'm not going to, you know, do something and act like I've got it when I don't. I'm like this. If God's got something, I want the real deal. I don't want nothing fake. So anyway, I sought God for about 2 years. And finally, I just, one Sunday night at youth, I just gave up. And I said, Lord, I love you. I said, this is too painful for me. It's rejection. And I said, I can't take this rejection. So I said, I tell you what, I'm going to make a deal with you. If you want to fill me with the Holy Spirit, you know where I live, and I ask you to fill me, but I can't seek you anymore. It's too painful. So I quit going to youth group. So in church one Sunday morning, my pastor made the announcement that morning, and me and Mama was sitting on the church pew, and he said, we're going to be praying for people this coming Tuesday night to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. And he said, if you have never received the Holy Spirit and you want it, he said, we want you to come. And he said, if you have a young person that's never received the Holy Spirit, he said, let them come, and we'll have men here that'll take time with the young men. We'll have women here that'll take time with the young women. And we'll pray with them until they have, you know, received the Holy Spirit. We won't give up on them. So when he said that behind the pulpit, I felt something for the first time in a long time. I was 14. So I turned to Mama in the pew, and I said, Mama, can I go? And she said, yeah, absolutely. So I remember I went home on Sunday after church, and I started praying immediately. And I said, Lord, oh, my God, I said, please fill me with the Holy Spirit. I said, Lord, I'm hungry for you, and I just want you to touch me, Lord. And I said, I want something that's real. I'm not going to fake it. I want something that's real. So I woke up on Monday. I prayed all day Monday, and I woke up on Tuesday morning. And when I woke up, my eyes come open. I said, oh, my God, today's Tuesday. I'm going to receive the baptism tonight. So I remember I had to walk to school, and I had to walk home. And so I got to school that morning in first class, and it was biology class. And they were showing a film on dissection, and I was sitting there watching the film, and I was seated alphabetically in the classroom, you know. And the projector was right by my head, so I was just sitting there, and I didn't have my mind on that dissection at all. And I was just praying under my breath, Lord, tonight, oh, Lord, tonight, please fill me with the Holy Spirit. So my name is John Alton Kilpatrick. Before, nobody had ever called me John in my life. Everybody always called me Alton. I was named after my grandfather. But nobody had ever called me John, although that was my name, John Alton. So while I was watching the film on dissection and praying, it was just like a hand reached over and cut the volume down. And I heard the volume go down on the projector. I didn't. When it did, I jumped. And I thought, man, it just felt, I felt strange. When I heard the volume go down, it was almost like I was sort of leaving the room. And so I jumped, and then I had a moment to get my bearings. And then when I settled down, I heard in my left ear the audible voice of the Lord. And he didn't call me Alton, he called me John. And he said, John, this day I have called you to preach my word. He said, but you must keep yourself from the other boys and girls in the neighborhood that'll have a bad influence on you, because if you don't, I'll lose you. And then he said, bam, 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 you know, five things. He popped off five things that he was calling me to do. And as soon as he got through naming those five things that he was calling me to do in my life, he said, this day I will confirm this call in your ear. So as soon as the Lord quit speaking, I heard the projector come right back up. But I couldn't feel my legs at all. It felt as though I had no lower body whatsoever. It felt like it just disappeared. And so when the Lord got through speaking to me, I was in shock, because it's like, in my 14-year-old mind, I was thinking, my God, he knows where I go to school. You know? It's like, wow, he really is God. You know? And it just shocked me that he knew where I went to school. I went to Arnold Junior High School, and I was sitting there, and it just took me a while to assimilate everything. And then I just couldn't believe God spoke to me, and I couldn't believe he called me John. And then the bell rang, and my next class was a math class. And when Mama would always have shirts for me. I wouldn't wear bandlons and things like that back then. I only wore shirts to school that would have a pocket where I could take my New Testament with me to school. And so in between, you know, getting my work done, if we ever had some free class time, I'd pull my Bible out and read my New Testament. Not trying to be super spiritual. I love the Word of God. And I would read it, and it would bring me comfort. So my math teacher always made fun of me, and she'd call me, oh, class, he's reading his Bible again. And they'd laugh, you know, and have a big time over it. So this particular day, when God called me, my next class was math class. But oh, God's good. When I got there, she was out that day. And filling in for her was a retired Baptist preacher. And so When I walked into class, I had all my books with me, and I set them on my desk, and they were about that high, and I was sort of hiding behind my books, still trying to simulate what happened to me last period. And so my teacher was sitting there, and he'd taught that class two or three times before. His name was Richard Chaplin. And he looked back over the class, had his glasses on the end of his nose, and he looked back there at me, and I said, so he walked back there to where I was, and he said, "Son, what's going on with you, man?" I said, "Why do you ask?" He said, "I see the glory of the Lord all over you." And I said, so I started crying. And I felt like I was going to cry even before I got to class. I just felt like I was going to cry. And so he said, "I see the glory of the Lord on you." And I told him what happened last period. And well, he started sobbing. Well, when the bell rang for class to start, we was both squalling, you know. So I thought that was a confirmation. So that day, the feeling began to return in my legs. And I had to walk to school, so I ran home. Mama had to be at work at 4 o'clock at the nursing home. So when school let out at 3:25, if I would run home, she'd have me a sandwich fixed and some iced tea. And she'd always pray over me before she went to work. And we'd have a few minutes to talk. So that day, I couldn't wait to get home and tell Mama what happened. So I ran up the steps, and I said, "Mama, come here!" And I snatched the screen door open, and Mother came out of the back of the house real slow. You know, she just came out of the back of the house real slow, real pensive. And I said, "Mama, sit down. I've got something to tell you." She said, "No, son." I said, "You sit down." And I thought, oh, my God. I was about to bust. And she said, "Sit down." She said, "A woman came by here today selling donuts for the Church of God." Does that sound like Pentecostal? And she said she was selling donuts for the Church of God. And she said, "I'd never met her in my life. And Mother had me when she was almost 42. So by now, Mother's about 56, and I'm 14. So Mama said, "This woman said, would you like to buy some donuts? We're selling them for a fundraiser." So Mother went back to the back, got a dollar out of her purse, came back, paid her through the screen door. And they exchanged no pleasantries. There was no pictures in the house on the piano or anything like that, you know. And so the woman still had a couple boxes of donuts under her arm. So when Mother paid her, she turned to walk off the porch, and she stopped dead in her tracks. And she laid the other two boxes of donuts on the banister. And she gave out a message in tongues on the front porch. And it said, "This day I've called your son to preach the gospel." "This day I've called your son to preach my word. And the Lord said, I'll be with him, but you must keep him from the other boys and girls in the neighborhood that'll have a bad influence on him." And then boom, 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 boom. All five things the Lord had called me to do that day, my mother repeated in my ear. And then my mother said, "Now, son, what was it she was going to tell me?" So, I've never doubted one time my call to the ministry. Now, after the Lord called me to preach, I remember I went to church on a Wednesday night with Mother. My dad was gone. Now, I'd been gone for about 2 years. I still was not myself. I still, you know, I was just having some struggles. So God called me to preach. That really touched me. And to hear the voice of the Lord, it changed my life forever. It just changed my life forever. So my brother-in-law's dad was the pastor of the church. His name was R.C. Wetzel. He was a German. I never met anybody like him before or anybody like him since. If I've ever met a man that had a walk with God, he was the real deal. He was prophetic, truly prophetic. He was truly a father. He was a man of God. And he actually became my father, my spiritual father, but he was almost like my real father. I couldn't tell any difference. My dad had left and abandoned me and my mother. So, Pastor came up to Mother that night at church on Wednesday night, and he said, "Irma," He said, would you let me take out, that's what he called me out, so he said, would you let me take out and teach him how to pray? And I'm standing there and I'm thinking to myself, I ain't called to pray, I'm called to preach, praise God. But he knew something that I didn't know, and what he knew was, if you're ever going to be a successful preacher, you've got to be a successful prayer. And he said, would you let me teach him how to pray? So Mama said, Brother Wetzel, would you do that for my boy? And he said, I will, because he said, I believe the hand of God's on him. So Mama released me to him, and I really just spent the night at home at night, Perry, just spent the night in my bed at home. And we had what we call midnight prayer meetings. The mills would get off at like 11 o'clock at night, the cotton mill and the foundries and all that. We had a bunch of cotton mills in Columbus, Georgia. And so when the cotton mills would get off, the men would come by that worked on the third shift, and they'd come by and wash up in the men's bathroom at the church, and they'd get there about 11:15, 11:20. We'd fellowship a little bit, but we started praying at midnight every night, and Pastor prayed every night, and I was with him every night for years, 7 days a week, after church on Sunday night, after church on Wednesday night. I was with him every night. And so when he said to Mama, he said, would you let me teach him how to pray? I was released to him, basically, and I stayed at home, like I said, in my bed, but that was about it. I was with him. Mama had such a struggle financially that Brother Wetzel never made over $90 a week. That's all they ever paid him. He gave me $15 a week. Because, see, his son was married to my sister, and he knew. Back then, I thought I was really his secretary. He asked me to be his secretary, and he gave me $15 a week. And without that $15 a week, we couldn't have survived. And he got by on $75 a week, and, of course, he lived in the parsonage. So I was with him in the afternoons when I got out of school, and when I got up older and I was in high school, then I got on the DCT program. Got out of school every day at 12:30, had to walk over to the church, was about 4 or 5 miles. And I would stay there. And then in the late afternoon, he would take me to a cafe somewhere. We'd fellowship and just be together. And God was healing me and restoring me because my concept of men wasn't good at all. So God was healing me and restoring me. And I was calming down and I was feeling hope for the first time. So we would eat out at the cafe and, you know, just spend great time. And, man, that guy was, I used to really wonder, is he an angel or is he really a man? I found no fault in him. He was that godly. He was brilliant. He had a photographic memory. He could open up an encyclopedia, scan the page with his finger, close that book, and quote every word on that page. That's the kind of mind that he had, but he was humble as an old shoe. And I saw people do him like dirt, and he always was gracious. And he lived a life before me that it restored my confidence in humanity, but it also put an inbred respect in me for the ministry and for Pentecost, because he's a powerful Pentecostal preacher. So I remember I started praying with him, and listen, I want you to listen to this point really good. If you're a pastor, I really want you to listen to this point really good. If you're watching online, please don't jump over this point. This is so important. When I first started praying with him, I felt so deprived. He was in his 60s, and I was 14. Many nights, there would be 8, 10, 12, is sometimes even as high as 30, 35 people. But most nights in prayer meetings, it was just me and him. So my father's gone now. Mama's working at the nursing home. I had nobody at home. My sisters were older than I was. They was working. So I basically was just with him. And I felt so alone. I felt so deprived. It's like I was a Samuel that had been relinquished to the man of God in the house of God. And so when we first started praying, we'd go in the nighttime hours of that cafe and get a bite to eat, and I'd pass by on 2nd Avenue, and I'd hear the ball connect with the bat, And you see the kids out there on the ball field, and you can see the lights, and you can see the ball sailing up past the lights, and you can see parents standing up in the bleachers cheering their kids on, you know. And I used to pass by and see that, and I thought, well, where's my dad? And where's my mother? I have no life. I'm with this old man. Every night, I'm with this old man. And I just felt so alone in the very beginning. But, oh, my God. I didn't know the plan that God had for my life. And I didn't know what God was going to do in my life. And I didn't know that that man was a golden connection that God had put in my life that was going to connect me to my future of what God had for me. And so we started praying. And then he began to teach me about prayer. He began to tell me about the different kinds of prayer. He began to teach me the word. Now let me tell you something else he would do. Every night before we would pray, before those meal shifts would get off, even after church on Sunday night and after church on Wednesday night, he would go upstairs at a blackboard, and he'd write out lessons on the blackboard, and he'd teach the Word of God. Sometimes there'd be other young preachers in there. Many times just be me. But he'd take that time, and he would teach us. Like, I remember the first class he ever taught before those prayer meetings was the Adorable Godhead. And he taught on God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And I sat there mesmerized. I'd never heard that kind of stuff. It was going into my spirit. He had sweetness of lips. It increased the learning in my life. And as I sat there and listened to him, and as I heard what he was teaching, it became a part of my genetic spiritual makeup. And he did that every night, 7 days a week, for years. And then after he would teach us an hour, he'd walk up to one of us in the room and hand us the chalk. And he'd say, now teach me what I just taught you. So you'd better be listening. And so when I would get up there, a lot of times, and there's other kids in the room there, other boys in the room, when I'd get up there, I was nervous, had no self-confidence. I'd try to teach, and he was so sweet. I was nervous, I was shaken, and he was so sweet and so kind, so compassionate. And if I'd make a mistake, he would say, now, son, that's not what I said now. He said, now, one day you're going to be in the ministry, and one day you're going to be a preacher. And he said, if you make that kind of a statement to people, he said, that's wrong, doctrinal. And he said, let me tell you what I said. And then he'd straighten me out. And he did that every night of my life. For years. Honestly, when I got to Bible school, I didn't really learn that much in Bible school because I had already gone through Old Testament with him, New Testament with him, Holy Spirit with him every night, and he taught me all that stuff. So anyway, as we began to pray, he began to teach me about prayer. And many nights, like I said, it was just me and him. And I'd listen to him, and what he would do. Now, let me tell you this also. Don't forget this part. This is so important. He said at 11:30, we always started praying at 12. He'd take 30 minutes every night, no matter who was there, if it was just me or if there was 30 men there. We always prayed with the lights out. And he would lay in the floor. He'd take his tie off. He'd take his coat off, roll his shirt sleeves up. And he'd lay on the floor, take his shoes off in the dark, and he'd tell preacher stories. When he would tell them preacher stories about people getting saved, people getting filled with the Holy Spirit, people being healed, how he used to walk in the railroad tracks at night and go to Brush Harbor meetings and I'd lead people to God, you know, and all this kind of stuff. My heart would burn, man. I mean, it's like somebody light a torch in my heart. My heart would just burn. I'd hear them preacher stories. He told them every night for years. After a while, I heard his story so much, I could tell him as good as he could tell them. But I used to lay on the floor, and I used to wonder, well, Lord, because I felt so insignificant. And he was everything. He was brilliant. He was godly. He was a powerful preacher. And I just felt so honored to be with him. And I used to think to myself, Lord, I remember saying one night while I was laying on the floor there and he was telling these stories, I said under my breath, I said, Lord, you reckon one day I'll have any preacher stories to tell? I just didn't know what God was going to do. I said, Lord, you reckon one day I'll have any preacher stories to tell? And so my heart would burn. And then after he'd talked for about 30 minutes, he'd get up. He'd say, all right, boys, it's time to pray. He said, now take the gum out of your mouth. I don't want to see y'all standing off over here somewhere in the shadows talking. I don't want to see you cutting up. I want you to pray. It's time to pray. And we started praying. And when I first started praying with him, I didn't know how to pray. He taught me how to pray. And after a while, what I felt deprived, and when I felt like I was being cheated out of life and the joys and the pleasures of being a kid, all of a sudden as we begin to pray, and let me tell you something, you can't pray long, especially with somebody that knows God and they have a walk with God, you can't pray long until things begin to happen. And things begin to happen, and all of a sudden my eyes were open and my life changed. But I'm going to tell you one story real quickly. This is the most important thing that ever happened to me. Pastor had a revival at the church, and I still remember the evangelist's name to this day. He was a handsome evangelist, very talented, powerful preacher, wasn't married. Pastor invited him in. The revival was powerful. It took off. It went for about 6 or 8 weeks. The church was just slammed full. The pastor was in his 60s. The evangelist was in his 20s. And so the evangelist came in. The church was growing, people being saved, all kind of stuff. But I remember one day, pastor called the evangelist in and he said, now, son, he told me about it. He didn't do this in front of me, but he told me about it. He said, now, son, he told the evangelist, he said, I know something's wrong. I can't put my finger on it, but I know something's wrong. The Holy Spirit showed me something's wrong. He said, I want to end the revival because I know something's not right. So he ended the revival. Well, when he did, the church turned against pastor. But let me tell you what happened. When pastor ended the revival, he found out that that evangelist was funneling some of the boys in the church. And the people that left the church in droves found out about it. And you think they came back and apologized to the pastor? No, sir. They stayed gone, even though they learned that the evangelist had fondled these kids. Even went to jail. The evangelist went to prison, and the people never came back to the pastor and said, we're sorry. So I saw, when I was 14 years old, I saw church trouble early, and it had to do with revival. So here's what happened. The church went down, 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 down. I've been praying with pastor now for about a year. Now I'm 15 years old. This particular Sunday night after church, on that Sunday, the church was so heavy, the atmosphere in the church was so heavy, you could cut it with a knife. It just, you felt trouble in the air. You felt hell in the house. What was once a full church, vibrant, exciting, now just a little corporal's guard left, very difficult. So this particular Sunday night after church, pastor took me and about 5 or 6 other young men up to the cafe. We was getting a bite to eat. And after we ordered, he leaned back in his chair. I'll never forget this as long as I live. He leaned back in his chair and he said, boys, he said, I've got some news for you. He said, I'm going to be leaving. Well, man, when he said that, I got a frog in my throat, and I couldn't get it up, and I couldn't get it down. I felt like I was choking. My father had left me, and now my spiritual father's leaving me. And he said, as you well know, he said, the church is in real distress. He said, I'd do it all over again if I had to do it all over again. I know I did the right thing. But he said, I'm going to Lake Wales. He said, I'm going to Winter Haven, Florida. And he said, there's a church there that wants me to come, and I'm going to be leaving. And he said, I know God will give you somebody else that will love you like I've loved you. And I said to myself, man, listen, nobody's going to love us like you've loved us. And I was crushed. Because now he hadn't just become my pastor, my spiritual father. He was my daddy. And now he says he's leaving. It hurt so bad. I can't tell you how bad it hurt. So I got quiet. I couldn't talk. I felt like I was going to bust out crying. I didn't want to embarrass myself, and I didn't want to embarrass him. I just got quiet. So we came back to the church that night. And so whenever he laid down on the floor at 11:30 and started telling his preacher stories, I went over and sat in the audience on the pews in the dark by myself, and I held myself like this, and I was just rocking back and forth, and I was aching. I was hurting so bad. And I said to myself, God, I can't go through this anymore. I said, this is too painful. I said, church is painful to me. The greatest pain I've ever suffered has been in church and about the things of God. And I said, so I said to myself, I'm going to catch a city bus and I'm going to ride the bus home. But the city bus in Columbus, Georgia ran every day and every night except Sunday night. And it didn't run Sunday night. And I remembered it didn't run. And I thought, well, I can't catch the bus. And that was back during the 60s, around 65. And so they was having a lot of looting and burning because of civil rights marches in Columbus. It was too dangerous to walk home. And I just felt trapped. I just felt like, well, my God, if I could just get out of here, I'd never come back to church. If I could just leave, I'd never come back. I'd never trust anybody in my life. And I just felt trapped. So I just sat there and I thought, man, I can't wait till this is over and I get to go home. I'll never come back. Never. I can't take this kind of pain. So I remember pastor got up out of the floor and he said, it's time to pray, boys. And he started to praying. I started walking around. And his favorite place to pray was always behind the last pew on that side of the church. And he would kneel down or lay down in the floor, and he would just start moaning and groaning before he'd start praying. He'd just start moaning and groaning like an old cow bellering, you know. And he'd just start moaning and groaning in the spirit. And so he lay there, and I'm still sitting out in the audience. And that night, there was 17 of us in the prayer meeting that night. 17 men and young men, grown men, young men. And so he started praying, and I saw other ones getting up, and they was moving around there starting to pray. But it really felt like somebody had tilted that building up on a tilt. And just to walk in that church, it was so oppressive, so spiritually heavy to pray in that church. I got up a time or two and tried to pray, but it literally burned the muscles in my legs just to walk and try to pray. So, you know, needless to say, I was just a kid, only 15 years old. I just went back and flopped down the seat, and I just said, my God, I'd leave if I could. And so they hadn't been praying 10 minutes. And I saw Junior Kirkland, a guy in our church, he's about 6'6". I could see the figure of his body, and he come up and sit down on the altar. We had altars on this side of the church and altars on that side. And he sat down on the altar, and he said, well, boys, I think I'm going to put on my shoes and go to the house. And so he reached down to take his shoes and put them on. I don't think he ever touched his shoes. He just sat back up. And then, in just a matter of minutes, everybody had quit praying except Pastor. And I'm still sitting out in the audience, and everybody's sort of lined up on those altars. Well, I looked, and here comes Pastor. He never prayed less than an hour or an hour and a half. And we've only been praying less than 15 minutes. So it felt a little bit spooky in there. So I got up. I got up and I moved up and I sat right by Pastor. And listen, this is the honest truth and a true story. If it wasn't true, I wouldn't play with your emotions, but it's true. When we sat down on that altar bench, something came in that church, a holy hush came in that church. And before the church was remodeled, it was about probably 20-foot ceilings in the church, and we had big metal doors in the back, and they went up like this, and they had metal doorknobs, And those doors were locked five ways. They had pins in the jamb at the top, pins in the jamb at the bottom, a key beneath the doorknob, a deadbolt, and a latch. They were locked five different ways. While we were sitting there on the altar bench, a power hit them doors, and they both flew open at the same time. Just boom, they just flew open. With just enough power that to this day I can still hear those metal doorknobs just tap those plaster walls. In off the stage, or in off the porch, walked one angel. And he came, and he came in off the porch through the back doors. He came in the back of the sanctuary, and he went and stood where Pastor always prayed. Just stood right there. Had no wings. Never said a word. Looked like a warrior. He was a massive man. I've never seen anything that massive in my life. He filled that church from the top to the bottom. To see something move that big was awesome. I can't even give you the words of how it looked to see something move that big. And he just stood there, and then right behind him came another one. And he stood on the right-hand side of the church, and I had started the church library because I was a pastor's secretary. And I remember I had a big old bookcase in the back of the sanctuary, and that's where I had the library for the church where people could check out books, you know. And that big old bookcase was so rickety, it had pieces of cardboard under it, you know, to keep it from falling over. And I used to think, my God, the thing was so big, I thought if it ever fell on me, it'd kill me. Nobody'd ever find me, you know. When that angel stood by that big old huge bookcase, it looked like a little matchbox. And I'm 15 years old now. And I'm sitting there on the altar bench, 15 years old, and I'm looking at these angels, and I'm saying to myself, my God, it's not good that I be here. You know, this is big boy stuff. And I remember I said this to myself. I said, look long and look hard. You may never see this again. And I remember I looked over at that angel, and there was no wings. Neither one of them ever said a word. They stood just at attention like this. And you could see them in the dark. There were street lights coming in. Once your eyes get adjusted to the dark, you'd be surprised how good you can see. And they just stood there like this. But around the shoulders and around the head, there was like an aura of something. It had like an energy field. I can't explain it. But around their shoulders and around their head was like an aura, sort of like a halo type thing, but it wasn't a halo. But it was energy. You could see it. And as I sit there and I looked at it, I looked at this one, and then I looked at that one where Pastor always prayed. And I looked back over here, and I looked at that one. And the doors were open in the back. Now, remember, those doors were locked five ways. And we never even used those doors except on Sunday morning. We wouldn't even unlock them, you know, except Wednesday night and Sunday morning. They were just an ordeal to open. Bam! When that power hit both those doors, they flew open and didn't even tear nothing up. So I'm standing there looking at this, or sitting there looking at this, and I said to myself, I can't afford to forget this. 15 years old. The first one that moved in just a minute, like they received some kind of a signal from another world, just stepped out like this from the wall. And he turned just like a soldier. And he went back to the center aisle, turned like that, and walked out on the porch and disappeared. The next one stepped out the same way, came to the center aisle, turned just like a soldier, and walked out and disappeared in the night. Left those doors open. Pastor got right up. I don't think you can really grab what I'm going to tell you, but whenever I tell you that that man was a man of God, please understand that I'm telling you he was a man of God. I don't think that was that unusual for him. If God ever did things like that, he would never brag about it. He was tight-mouthed. He was closed-lipped. He was a man of integrity, high integrity. And I don't think that had been the first time he'd ever experienced that, because he calmly got up when they walked out. They hadn't been out 2 minutes. And he calmly got up, never said a word to any of us. There's 17 of us sitting on that altar. And he starts walking. You can see that white shirt. He starts walking down that center aisle, and he's going back there to shut them doors. That's what he's going to do. Well, man, I wasn't going to let him get out of my sight. I jumped right in behind him, you know. And we all got right in behind him. I didn't want to be left up there, you know, praise God. So we all jumped right in behind him like a hen leading a little brood of chicks, you know. And when we got back there, listen, when we got back there, this is the first really powerful experience I ever had in my life. When we got back there to the back, to the foyer, where those angels walked in, there was so much power in that foyer that it was like sticking fire to butter. Your legs, it wasn't a matter of going out in the spirit, your legs would not hold you up. And I mean, I've been down before in the spirit and remained conscious, but we all went completely out. Piled up in the floor like somebody played fiddlesticks with us. Just piled up in the floor. Well, the next morning, about 6:30, the sun was coming up out of the east, and we had stained windows in the church, and the sun was coming up in the east through those stained glass windows, and it was hitting us all in the face, and we were piled up even on top of each other. I was laying on one man's legs below his knees, and we were just all clumped up together. And when the sun came up, we all woke up, and those doors were still open from the night before. Still open. And that was Monday morning. So pastor didn't say anything, but evidently the word got out. And remember, that Sunday church was hellish. Nobody there. It was hellish. But Wednesday night, word had spread about those angels coming in the church. And that place was packed and standing room only on Wednesday night. So that Wednesday night, back then we didn't have worship like we have now. We called it song service. You remember? We had a song service, and whenever the song service was going on, the Spirit of God began to move. But it was during the offering. Pastor said, bow your head and let's pray over the offering. 38 people fell out of their seats into the floor and received the baptism in the Holy Ghost. During the offering prayer, fell in the floor and received the baptism in the Holy Spirit. And listen, here's what happened. The Lord spoke to Pastor Wetzel that night, and he said, Raymond, I don't want you to leave this church. He said, I want you to stay here with these boys, and I want you to pour into these boys. Because he said, they'll reach more in their generation than you'll ever reach in your generation. And he stayed. Can you shout amen? I said, can you shout amen? But let me tell you something. During that period of time, I was 15, and I saw those angels. They are indelibly burned in my spirit to this day. I don't care what I go through. If it's a financial need, if it's a spiritual battle or whatever, here's what I saw. I saw a church on the verge of dissolving. I saw a pastor brokenhearted. I saw a church that had scattered. I saw a lie that had been perpetrated against our pastor. I saw an evangelist sitting in jail. People refused to come and humble themselves before the pastor. I was about to leave that church that night. I would have missed those angels. I was within 5 minutes of having one of the greatest experiences of my whole life, and I almost missed it. If I could have caught a city bus, I'd have been gone, and nobody, even if they told me about the angels, I probably wouldn't have believed it. I was hurting so bad, but God had me trapped. And I want to tell you something, friend. Oh, hallelujah. I said hallelujah. There's times that you'll feel like that you're trapped and you can't go anywhere. It may be God fixing it where you can't go anywhere. Woo! Shout amen. Hare Sato. Lift up your hands right quick. I feel something in here right now. Come on. Lift your hands and praise Him. Everybody, stand up for just a minute. I'm going to finish here, but come on. Lift your hands up. Shitara Satoto. Come on, lift your voice. Woo! Woo! Oh, come on, you can do better than that. Come on, lift your voice. The Holy Ghost is in the house. Come on. Woo! Woo! Come on, church, help me. Lift your voice. Get that silence off of you. Come on, lift your voice. Woo! 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 Shatararabasantobobobobobakata. My God, something's in this house. I can feel it. Yeramandalobokotedibiandarabasanto. Barasatakopapayanto. Woo! Mighty, 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 mighty. Reach over and touch somebody right now. Ladies with ladies and men with men. Pray for one another just real quick. I'm not through. Just touch somebody right now and pray for them. Men with men. Ladies with ladies. Do it. Woo! Shararama sanololobokora bayandololobosantaba. Oh, come on, church. Jesus. Jesus. Call out to him. He's passing by now. Woo! My God, I feel that. The Holy Ghost is in the house. Come on. Shilele yando hora yando basana biyando. Mandara basato kore biyando. Yatara bandara biyante. Roli biyara basana mando bokore yando. That's it. Come on. Come on. Jesus, let God touch you, friend. Let God touch you right where you are.
Touch her. With a fresh anointing.
Thank you, Jesus. For just a minute before we change the order of the service, begin to worship the Lord in your prayer language, everybody. Stir up the Holy Ghost that's within you. Come on. Everybody. Stir up the Holy Ghost that's within you. Stir it up. Stir it up. Stir up the gifts. Stir it up. Let God stir you tonight. You're doing good. Come on. This is good. This is good. Ramamando hiri ene amanerene. What's going on in this house? What's going on here in Cleveland, Tennessee? What's going on at the Omega Center? Something's stirring in this place. Come on, help me, church. Stir it up. Woo! Woo! Shatarara molele ora boya na mama. You can be seated. Habara mahola mayana masana. Hidarara mora makantora romayanto. Man. Go ahead. It's all right. Listen, that's why we're here. I'm not going to stop this. You know, if I get a chance to go on, I'll go on, but I'm not going to stop the Holy Spirit. You let God touch you right where you are. Go ahead. Lift your voice if you want to. It's okay. Come on. Those of you that's watching by live streaming, right there where you are, in your home, or a motel room, wherever you are, let God touch you right where you are. I believe God's stirring there just like He is in here. Hinanama sarabayanto korobayando. Ooh, I was in Brownsville. We built a new sanctuary, and I was in Brownsville. And I went in the church after we got the church built, and I was walking around, and I said, God, I said, you know, I've got everything in the world to be thankful for. And I said, loved by my congregation. I've been here at that time, you know, about 12 years. Church had grown from less than 300 to about 2,000 people. Church was doing great. I had respect to the community. I was on television worldwide. Built the new sanctuary. That sanctuary construction took 3 years, a year for construction, a year for the financial planning, and a year for the architectural. So I was in over 200 meetings just to build Brownsville. And after I got the church built, I was just absolutely burnt out. So the church was beautiful. It was new. We grew 700 new people as soon as we built the church. We never lost them. We gained 700 new people just like that. But I was busy, busy, busy. I was tired. So I remember I went to the church, and we hadn't been in there but maybe a week or two. And whenever I pray, I always like to pray privately. I don't like to pray publicly in front of people. That's just me. Now, that may be not other people, but that's me. I don't like to pray publicly. I like to pray before the Lord privately. So I went in the church, and I locked the door behind me, and before I cut the lights off, I looked under all the pews, make sure nobody was in there or whatever. And I just began to just cry out to God. And I reminded myself of my pastor. I couldn't even pray in English. I couldn't even pray in just a normal language. All I could do was groan and moan, just like an old cow, just beller. And I said, God, I said, Lord, I feel so guilty even telling you this. But I said, Lord, I've got everything a man could want. I've got a wife that loves me dearly. I've got two sons that's never give me no trouble. I've got wonderful daughter-in-laws. I've got grandchildren. I said, but God, why am I so lonely? I said, I got this new church. I'm on television. My church loves me. There's no trouble. I said, God, I feel so guilty even ask you this, but I said, God, why am I so lonely? And I heard the Lord say this to me, and it was no delay. He just completely said, if you'll make this a house of prayer and return to the God of your childhood, he said, I'll pour out my spirit in this place. And as soon as the Lord said, if you'll make this a house of prayer, and he said, if you'll return to the God of your childhood, I knew exactly what he was talking about. Because I remembered my childhood with my pastor. I prayed with him for years. Even after I went to Bible college, and I got out of Bible college, and I took my first church in Vidalia, Georgia, which was central Georgia, I'd drive 3 hours when I took my first little church, only had 40 people. I'd drive 3 hours one way to pray with him and drive 3 hours home and go to work the next day just to pray with him for 2 or 3 hours. And so the Lord said, if you'll return to the God of your childhood, he said, I'll pour out my spirit. And I said, well, Lord, I know what it means to pray. I prayed with my pastor. I know and I love prayer. But I said, Lord, you know whenever you make a church and you start calling a prayer meeting, it's the least attended service of the whole week. And I said, Lord, you're going to have to give me a strategy. And he did instantly. It was a download, just that quick. And so I came up with 12 prayer banners. And each one had titles on the prayer banners, categories of prayer. And I set them up in the audience. And I set them up on the balcony all down below in Brownsville. And there was like warfare banner. There was leaders of our country banner. There was healing banner. There was banner for pastors and ministers. There was a revival banner that my wife was over. And if you moved around, and the church was in constant movement after we had praise and worship, and I dismissed them to pray on Sunday nights. If you moved around and prayed 5 minutes at each prayer category, you prayed an hour because there was 12 banners, 12 times 5 is 60. So whenever we first started praying, the devil jumped up on my shoulder and he tormented me for a year. You better stop this prayer. You don't stop this, you're going to lose your crowd. People's going to go where there's preaching. They're not going to come out for prayer. You better stop this. I'm telling you, if you don't stop it, you're going to lose them. But I began to hear from my congregation, and they said, Brother Kilpatrick, by the time we work all week, we got kids in school, and we're married and got husbands and wives, by the time we get home from work and we help kids with homework and we get through cooking and settle in, we're so tired a lot of times we just don't even have time, we don't have the strength to pray. Thank you for this prayer meeting on Sunday night. And the church grew by over 20% on Sunday nights. And we began to pray. And when we first started praying, people had no problem because they had prayer categories to move around. The church is in constant movement. You can go to whichever prayer banner you wanted to anytime. But if you prayed 5 minutes around each prayer banner, you prayed an hour. Well, then they started praying 2 hours on Sunday nights. And the glory of God started moving in the church. We prayed 2.5 years before revival broke out. Every Sunday night, we prayed 2.5 years. Now listen to this. Let me tell you something. I want you to really pay attention to what I'm going to tell you, because I'm going to deal with something that I'm sure probably a lot of you can relate to. You remember a while ago I told you that right before those angels came in, I almost missed them? When we first started praying, it felt like revival was going to break out any second. I mean, expectancy was thick. We first started praying, it was like, my God, whoa, man, revival's coming to Brownsville. We kept praying 2.5 years, and the longer we prayed, it felt like to me it was completely out of touch. I felt completely removed from revival. Felt like it was only a word. I had no expectancy. It had all drained out on me. Matter of fact, I'm going to be honest with you. Before revival broke out at Brownsville, I had called some district superintendents of the assemblies in different districts and asked them if there was any churches open. I was trying to leave Brownsville. I was actually trying to leave and take another church somewhere because I felt like revival would never happen. And I called New Mexico. I called Texas. I called California. I called Arizona. I called different districts, and they all said, Brother Kilpatrick, there's nothing open that you'd be interested in. And I here again, I felt trapped. You know what I'm beginning to learn now? You know what I'm beginning to learn? I'm beginning to learn that whenever I'm trying to go, it means the devil's got his crowbar out and he's trying to pry me out because he knows something's about to come. Can I tell you right now? Listen to me. If the devil got his crowbar in behind your back and he's trying to pry you out of a place, it's a dead giveaway. Something's about to happen. Stay where you are. I said, stay where you are. Stay in that prayer closet. I almost missed the Brownsville revival. Now listen to this. Right before revival broke out, my mother died. And like I told you, my mother was so important to me. And we prayed 2.5 years, man. And she died 5 weeks before revival broke out. She died the Sunday before Mother's Day. And revival broke out on Father's Day. So she died. She'd been dead 5 weeks. I was still grieving. So Steve Hill had been a friend of mine for years, had preached for me many times at Brownsville. He had preached many, many times at Brownsville. I can't tell you how many times. Always did good. He was always a missionary type evangelist type person. People liked him. He did good. But he had been to Holy Brompton in England, and God had touched him. And also, Leonard Ravenhill had died, and Leonard Ravenhill was his spiritual father. So I booked Steve. He called me and said, have you got a Sunday? And I said, yeah. And I looked over my calendar, and he said, I said, Steve, the only Sunday I got is Father's Day. He said, that'll be fine. And so I said, okay, go ahead and come on Father's Day. So when my mother died, we went out with Steve on that night before revival broke out. And while we were sitting in the restaurant, Brenda had been touched, my wife. God had powerfully touched her life. Steve had been touched, but I had been with my mother so long as she was suffering and dying of pancreatic cancer, I hadn't been touched. I felt cold. I felt left out. I felt out of touch, unplugged. So whenever Brenda got back And Steve came on that night before Father's Day. We all went out to the Red Lobster to get a bite to eat. And so while we were sitting there, Brenda got to talking about how God had touched her. Steve got to talking about how God had touched him. You know, and I'm sitting there like a knot on a log. I didn't feel nothing. So I went back to the house that night, and I went to sleep, and I woke up the next morning, and I said to myself, I'm not going to church today. It was Father's Day. 95. You remember a while ago I told you I almost missed the angels? I almost missed the revival. I woke up on Father's Day morning. I was so discouraged. They had been so blessed the night before. I was so discouraged. And I said to myself, man, I'm still grieving my mother. I'm just going to let Steve's going to preach. He's preached here many times. I'm just going to have a staff member take the service. I'm going to let him go. So I was reaching for the telephone, and I was going to call one of my staff members and say, you know, go ahead with the service today. I didn't do it because the Holy Spirit let a little girl's face come before my mind, and it was Father's Day, and we had voted her daddy in as Father of the Year. And her daddy, her mother left her daddy and her for another man, and this little girl loved me like I can't tell you. She's just a little bitty blonde-haired, blue-eyed girl, but she loved me like her own daddy. She wouldn't even go to children's church. And whenever I'd get through preaching, she'd run up to me, wrap her arms around my legs, and look up at me. She'd say, I love you, preacher. And so that morning, I said, I'm not going to church this morning. And then, bam, her face came before me. And I remembered I had to present her father that morning with a plaque. I said, oh, shoot. So I knew I had to go to church. There again, God forced me. Wouldn't let me out of it. So I went to church that morning, and I just, my body language said I did not want to be there. I moped in. I flopped down on my chair. I wouldn't even let Steve sit on the platform with me, because when people would come in and see that I had a guest speaker, they'd turn around and walk out the door. And I'm not saying that bragging on myself. I'm just saying that's the way it gets sometimes with pastors. And so I just had Steve sit out in the audience. So whenever I got through presenting this plaque to this father, I said, Steve Hill's here this morning. He's going to come minister. And he came up there. Man, he's like somebody plugged him into the wall. I mean, he was just, you know. And I'd never seen him like that before. He'd preached for me many times, but man, he had been touched. He didn't look different. He sounded different. He walked different. His eyes looked different. And so he got up there and started preaching that morning. And he had 2 points to a sermon. Jesus loves you. Number one, and number two, he has a plan for your life. And that was his sermon, real deep. So when he got up there and started preaching, he kept saying every few minutes, oh my God, we're going to pray for you in just a minute, and God's going to mightily touch you. And I thought, okay, well, all right. And so he preached on a little bit more. We're going to pray for you in just a minute. God's going to mightily touch you. I'm telling you, friend, God's going to mightily touch you. And I thought, all right, yeah, okay. So he kept on, kept on. So finally, when he got through preaching, he just abruptly ended his message, and he popped off the platform, you know. Like a gazelle, you know, and I'm over there moping. And so he hops off the platform, and he says, if you want prayer, come forward now. And we had about 1,800 people there that morning. 1,000 people came forward for prayer. I was so stinking mad, friend. I was so mad. It's Father's Day. Now we got to pray for 1,000 people this morning. You know, they should be going home and having lunch with daddy today, but no, we got to pray for 1,000 people. So Steve just started, you know, and boom, boom, people started hitting the floor, and I thought, well, I've seen this before. You know, this is good. This is good. I've seen this before. Hallelujah, hallelujah. So I don't want to go down there. I don't want to help him. I'm mad because 1,000 people's come forward for prayer. I don't want to go down there and get in this circus. I'm depressed. Leave me alone. So finally, I got into conviction, and I said, well, it don't look good you sitting up here, John. The evangelist is knocking everybody out down there, and you up here looking like a dead meat. So I remember I struggled across the platform, and I just sort of moped across the platform, and I just sort of came down on the main floor. He was praying for one guy. He's about 6'8", big old man. I'm 6'3", you know, and So Steve's praying for this guy. And I just put my hand up on this guy's shoulder. He's a big old man. And I put my hand on Steve's back like this. And all of a sudden, I began to feel strange. Just felt a lot like I did when I heard that the voice of the Lord in the projector. I felt that way. And all of a sudden, I felt wind around my socks. I felt like a whirlwind around my socks. And I thought, whoa, 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 whoa. I'm glad I came down here, you know. So I felt wind whipping around my socks, and it felt like a breeze at first, like a strong breeze, and then it got to whirling around my ankles, both ankles. And I got to trembling like this, quivering, and that wasn't like me. I'm not going to fake anything. You just need to know that about me. I'm not going to fake anything. And it got to whipping around my ankles like that. And I got to quivering. And about that time, he left praying for that guy. And he walked on down to pray for somebody else. So whenever he left that guy, I'm left standing there, and I can't move. I can't walk. And so I'm saying to myself, Jesus, my feet won't move. You know, my feet usually moves when I tell them to move, but I can't move. And so a guy that got saved under my ministry on Easter was a bouncer in a bar, and he looked at me and said, hey, man, you all right? And I said, man, I don't know. I said, I can't walk. He said, let me give you a hand. And he come and got under my arm like this. And he said, where you want to go? I said, take me back up on the platform. Well, by that time, I'm hearing a noise in the church. Not only am I feeling wind, but I'm hearing a noise. And it sounded like a rushing, mighty wind. I promise you, it sounded like a wind. And we had a speaker cluster right up above the platform like this. And I heard up, and I thought, you know, it was the speakers. But I then realized it's not up there, it's coming this way. And all of a sudden, my legs flipped out just like this right here. They just flipped out, and my legs bowed out. And coming from behind me, it felt like an endless telephone pole coming between my legs. And it had a roar to it. And it just kept coming and coming and coming and coming and coming. And finally, I said, my God, help me up on the platform. And he got me up on the pulpit, and I could barely stand up. I was quivering. And I said, church! I said, man, this is it. This is what we've been praying for 2.5 years. Get in! As soon as I gave the word as the federal head chief of that church, as soon as I said, this is it, get in! It was like somebody was up in the balcony with machine guns. And that 1,000 people that came forward just started dropping like flies without anybody praying for them. Just started dropping like flies. And I had one guy in my church, he was the president of a steel corporation. I loved him and he loved me. But he never showed any movement in 13 years that I'd been there. He loved God. Even his mother was a preacher. She was a tent preacher, brush hopper preacher years ago. He was distinguished. He loved God. But he never showed any movement. Sometime when I'd preach, he'd maybe lift his hand or something. But he never showed no movement. And I looked, and people started dropping like flies. And I looked, and I saw him hit the floor and roll like a holy roller. And I said, oh, my God, we're in revival now. You know, whoo, yeah. Something going on in the house. And so all of a sudden, I couldn't stand up any longer. And I hit the floor. And nobody touched me. Nobody prayed for me. I just hit the floor. I couldn't stand up any longer. And whenever I hit the floor, I had been under stress so bad from that building program and everything. And I had stress backed up in my body. My joints were giving me a lot of trouble, and I couldn't hardly move good. I had like pleurisy. And so whenever I hit the floor, I had just got through preaching a series entitled The Glory of God. And I preached, I think, 15 parts on the glory of God. I preached the glory till they want nothing left to say about the glory. And I hit the floor, and whenever I hit the floor, I can't even talk. I can't even move my tongue. My eyelids dropped. I hit the floor. I had no control of my body. I tried to lift my head that far off the platform. I couldn't even lift my head. Totally conscious. But I couldn't even lift my head off the platform. And I said under my breath, I said, Lord, what is this? And the first thing he said to me was, Happy Father's Day. That's what he said to me. Happy Father's Day. Well, then the second thing he said to me was, now listen, let me back up just a minute. I was preaching in Virginia, and my mother, she went into a coma. And after the morning service, they came to me and said, Pastor, you need to call home. So I called home, and they said, Mama's in a coma. So I came all the way back home. I got there. My sisters was in the room, my nephews, my nieces, my wife, my kids. And I went right to the nursing home. As soon as I walked in that room, Mama came out of that coma. And she'd been in for days. So as soon as I walked in that room, she came out of the coma. And I walked over, and I sat down on the side of the bed. And I said, Mama, you know who this is? She said, it's my boy. I said, it is. I said, Mama, I said, I believe you're about to go to glory. You're about to go to heaven. She said, do you, son? She said, you know, it's strange. She said, there were three doctors dressed in white last night. Come in the room. And she said, one of them told me, we're going to be coming for you, Ira Mae. We're going to be taking you on a trip. And I sat there and I said, Mom, I believe you're fixing to go. She said, oh, my, do you? I said, yeah. I said, but now I want to ask you something. I said, before you go, I said, would you, when you get to heaven, would you ask Jesus to bless your boy? And she took that little arthritis finger and she said, I'll do that very thing. So whenever I hit the floor, when I was growing up, she used to put her arms around me all the time. And she said, son, I feel so sorry for you. And I said, why, Mama? She said, because you don't have a daddy. I said, oh, Mama, don't worry about that. I said, I'm fine. I said, you're my mom and my daddy. I don't need no daddy. You're that important to me. She said, oh, but I just feel so sorry for you. She'd tell me that several times a year, you know, just hug me and cry on me. So when I hit the floor that morning, I'm laying there, and I'm saying, Lord, what is this? And the first thing he said to me was, Happy Father's Day. Now, you know what happened? I'll tell you how the revival broke out at Brownsville. Mama died 5 weeks before. When she got there, she went right straight into the throne room where Jesus is. And I can hear her now. Now, Jesus, I understand you're about to pour out revival somewhere in the nations. And I just want to tell you, I want you to pour it out of my boy's church down there in Pensacola on DeSoto Street. Now, Lord, I want to ask you to do that for my boy. That's how revival broke out of Brownsville. But listen, whenever I hit the floor, I said, Jesus, I said, what is this? And I was really earnest in asking that question. And God's got a sense of humor. And he said, well, son, this is what you just got through preaching on. Remember I preached 15 parts in the glory? Here I was experiencing it. I preached 15 parts of it. And when it came, I didn't even know what it was. Can I tell you something? You've got to taste and see that the Lord is good. You can't hear about a secondhand experience. You've got to experience it yourself. Listen, our young people today don't want to hear about daddy's experiences anymore, our mama's experiences. They're saying, where are our miracles? We want an experience with God. We want a power encounter with God. And so whenever I laid there, honestly, here's what happened. It felt like somebody came and took my arm and just pulled it out of its socket. And I felt fluid draining out of the joints of my wrist, my elbow, and my shoulder. And all that stress was draining out of me. And I was worried, because I felt like literally liquid was leaking out of my joints. And I said, God, somebody's going to think I had an accident here on the platform. I was down from 12:30 to 4:30 in the evening. I couldn't open my eyes. I could hear God moving in the church that morning. I could hear him moving over here, touching hundreds of people. I could hear him going up in the balcony. I could hear him touching people up in the balcony. I could hear him over here touching hundreds of people. I wanted to see so bad, but I couldn't lift my eyes. So finally, after 4 hours, one of my sons came over to me and said, Daddy, you okay? I said, get me up. So they set me up on the platform. And when they set me on the platform, I said, wait a minute, come back. I said, put my hand under my chin. And they put my hand under my chin, and I lifted my eyelid so I could see. You know, I wanted to see. And listen, there was still a full house at 4:30 in the afternoon. I don't think a soul had left. That's the kind of presence was in there. This wasn't a Hope So revival. This wasn't some kind of emotional thing. Everybody stayed, and Brownsville was the kind of church, they weren't going to stay for some kind of sensational mess. Nobody left. And I lifted my eyelid like that, and I thought, Jesus, my God, look at this. Well, my first sight of revival was a little girl. I was sitting on my chair on the platform at Brownsville, and there was a little girl standing there. She wasn't five. I'll just say that. She was below five. Now, when I was laying on the floor, I remember when they brought the children's church in, because the parents wasn't mobile, they couldn't go get their children. So the workers in children's church had kept them, sang and patty clapped as much as they could, you know, gave them candy, and they couldn't keep them no longer, so they said, we're going to take them in the church to their parents. So people was laying all over the floor like dead bodies. That was a strange sight at Brownsville. That had never happened before. And I was the type pastor, I was ultra conservative. I wouldn't allow nothing like that. It had to be God, but I wouldn't allow it unless I knew it was God. And people were laying like dead bodies on a battlefield. And so this woman was just sitting up, and her little girl was standing in between her legs. And the woman was just sitting up in a sitting up position, and she's reaching for the waist of her little girl. And the little girl's sashes was untied. The little girl was barefooted. Her face was blood red, and she had tears all the way down in front of her little dress. And I remember the mama reached up to the little girl and she said, baby, are you okay? And the little girl never took her eyes off the ceiling. She said, mommy, don't you see him? And the mother said, see what, baby? She said, the angels in the ceiling holding hands. There was a time that if I'd have heard that, I'd have thought, well, she just wants attention. But after God put this old 6'3" boy down and I couldn't even lift my head, I knew that girl saw angels in the ceiling holding hands. That was my first sight of revival. And I said under my breath, I said, this thing will go 6 weeks at least. I didn't know it would go 5 years. I didn't know that 4.5 million people would come through the doors. But let me tell you what, people called it the Brownsville Revival. People called it the Pensacola Outpouring. People called it the Father's Day outpouring, but I'm going to have to be honest with you and tell you, I'm not real sure that it was revival. And let me tell you why I say that. Yes, we had manifestations of revival. Yes, we had souls. And yes, we had deliverances. But I tell you what I feel in my heart happened. I feel like it was a reintroduction to the modern day church of the glory of God. A reintroduction to the body of Christ of the presence of God. I was drunk for literally months. Could not function. Me and Steve would say goodbye to each other in those first months of revival after the sun had come up the next morning. It'd be already another day and the sun had come up. We'd say goodbye to each other. And God would never really move until in full power till after midnight. I can't explain it, but I think it so excited God and the Holy Spirit to see people stay in the presence of God from one day to another day, not going out to eat, not doing any of those things, but just staying in the presence of God, hungry for His presence, that after midnight, and it reminded me in the Bible, after midnight, Paul and Silas prayed, and the place shook, you know, and you just go all the way through the Scriptures, and you see what happened after midnight or at midnight, and God would start moving about midnight, and people would be called to preach. People would be delivered. Major healings. And whenever the Spirit of God came in like it did, I said to myself, man, this thing is going to go, I'm sure, for 6 weeks or 8 weeks. I didn't know it was going to go 5 years. I didn't know God was going to do what He was going to do. Let me tell you just a quick two or three things real quickly, and I'm going to stop. I could stand here and talk to you for 2 days without even Malik Batten and I could tell you story after story. I'm just going to stop in a few more minutes, but let me tell you this real quickly. When God would come in the church and healing would start taking place, we would never talk about it, because healing would usually take place during worship. And when Linda would be in deep worship and the people would be coming in from the nations of the world, there was new crowds every night. And Linda would start worshiping and the glory of God would come in and healing would start happening. It would feel like you'd be outside on a cloudy day and the sun would come out. You ever been out on a cloudy day and the sun come out and you could feel it on the back of your hands, you know, you could feel it on your neck? It would feel like the sun would come out. And I remember so well this particular night, this woman, Linda was leading worship, and we hadn't been in revival too very long, maybe less than a year. And there was just so many people, you couldn't even hardly move. And this woman just starts screaming. She starts screaming at the top of her lungs, and I'm thinking, my God. You know, if you go scream in my church, you need to have a good reason. Amen. You know, but somebody just screaming like that gets on my nerves. Like, shut up, woman. You know. And so she's doing this up and down. And she's shaking her hands like this. And she's just staring at her husband. And so I'm up here with Steve. And I'm thinking, well, what in the world's going on with her? So I reached over and grabbed a handheld microphone like this. And I came down off the platform. And she never even saw me coming. Didn't care that I was coming. And she just was screaming. And just staring at her husband. So I got down there, and I thought I was going to interview her. I couldn't interview that woman. She's screaming. She's just staring at her husband. Well, I looked at her eyes to see what she's looking at. And when I looked at her husband, he was a Vietnam veteran. And in Vietnam, they threw a grenade in on him, and to keep his guys from getting hurt, he picked the grenade up and tried to throw it, and it blew part of his hand off. His hand was growing back. I saw it. His hand was growing back. Now listen, I saw it with my own eyes. And I looked at what she was looking at, and I looked at him. He's a big old burly guy, and it blew a big moon out of his hand like this. And the meat was like an invisible sewing machine was whip stitching meat on his hand like that, and it was just coming back. Ah! I started screaming with her. Ah! You know, we screamed a duet. Listen to me. What I saw was the most supernatural thing I've ever seen. But it was the most natural thing I'd ever seen. And when I saw it, the first thing that crossed my mind was, my God, why haven't we seen this before? It looks so natural. This man's hand was growing back before our very eyes. And the meat that was coming on matched his suntan exactly. It wasn't like fresh pink meat. When God got through, it was like he had always had that hand. I almost fell out. Can you shout amen? Amen? Listen to me, friend. In the presence of the Lord, there's healing. There's salvation. There's deliverance. And here's what I'm trying to tell you. Church as usual will not get the job done anymore. We've got to have a move of the Holy Ghost. Can you shout amen? I'll tell you one more story and I'm going to quit. Listen to this one. It was the first Saturday night we started having services, because we always had prayer on Saturday night. It was the first Saturday night of having church revival, because people were flying in from the Orient and all over, and they were saying, well, we're flying in from all over the world now. You know, we'd like to be in revival. We thank God for the prayer meeting. So I moved prayer meeting to Tuesday night, and then we started having revival, you know, on the weekend so people could fly in. So it was our first Friday night of having revival. So we started at 6 o'clock on Saturday nights. I had to preach every Sunday. On Friday nights, there's so many people to pray for by the thousands. You wouldn't get home and get in the bed till after sun up the next morning. Then you can't hardly sleep in the daytime. Then now we got church on Saturday night. Now I got to get home on Saturday night after church and get a sermon for Sunday morning. I was beat. My eyes was stinging. My knees was quivering. I got on the platform that night. The place was jam-packed with people. I looked at Steve. His eyes looked like two burnt holes in a blanket. His eyes were bloodshot. He looked like he'd come off a drunk. And I looked at him and I said, "My God, man, you look awful." He said, "Well, evidently you hadn't looked in the mirror lately at yourself." I didn't say this to Steve, but I thought it in my mind. I thought, "I can't do this. I can't do this. I have to preach tomorrow. I have to be here with my people. I can't stay out all night like this and pray for all these people and go home and get a sermon. I can't do it." Our first one. And I'm just sitting there bewildered. I'm standing there bewildered. And I'm just saying, "I can't do this. I can't do this." And man, I got a living example of what it means in the scriptures. When I'm weak, He's strong. When I can't do it, He does it. So I looked up in the balcony, and we had sound soak on the balcony, you know, to help keep the echo down. And there was like fabric on the balcony at Brownsville. And I looked up there, and it looked like two soap bubbles had merged together. And it made me mad when I saw it. I said, "Some mother has sat there and let their kid blow soap bubbles on people down below. And them things are stuck to the thing." I thought, "My God, even in a revival, they can't even control their kids." You know. So I looked up there and the Holy Spirit said this to me. He said, "No." He said, "That's my healing virtue." And He said, "If you'll give the word right now, I'll explode it on the sick." So I jumped over. Linda was leading worship, and I jumped over and took a handheld microphone like this. And I didn't tell them what I saw. I didn't tell them anything. I just said, "If you're sick right now, go to the nearest aisle." The aisles filled up in less than 10 seconds. It was one mass of thousands of people, and it just filled up that quick. And I had something happen to me I've never had happen to me before. It was like I started throwing up words. It's like I was throwing up from my belly. I wasn't throwing up food. It didn't feel like I was vomiting, but I was literally throwing up words, and it was medical terms. And it was coming out of my belly. It wasn't coming out of my head. And I was calling out physical ailments that I had never even heard of, and people were screaming. They were falling backwards, the power of God. But all of a sudden, I was standing there, and we had a center aisle, and the place was completely full. But I remember I was just spitting out these medical terms. And just when my eyes got past the center aisle like that, I said, "Calcified disc and spurs." And when I said that, something flew out of my mouth about that long. It was smaller than this microphone, but it was silver. And it flew out of my mouth just like a bullet. And I saw it going a woman below her collarbone. And she screamed bloody murder. And she fell backwards. I mean, it knocked her backwards. She knocked five or six people down. And I said, "God, you killed that woman. She needs resurrected. She's a dead woman right there." And look here. I went back there, and her glasses was cocked on her nose. He said, "She's in so much pain she can't live. If she does take medication, she gets addicted. And she's living in hell, Pastor." And I said, "What happened?" And so he said, "Well, let's ask her." And they stood her up. And the first thing she did when she stood up is she put her palms on the floor without bending her legs. And I couldn't do that right now. And it was like somebody put shock absorbers in her back. And God healed her completely. Now, listen. Let me tell you what I think I saw. Now, I can't prove this, but let me tell you what I think I saw. I think the Lord let me see a living example of He sent His word and healed them. Because silver in the Bible stands for redemption. And so whenever that thing went in below her collarbone, I believe it was the word took a form and brought healing to her just like that. Can you shout amen? Amen. Have you got time for one more?
Yes.
Okay, one more. Just one more, I promise. Just one more. This man called. They called me from Atlanta. And they said, this man is coming down. He's a Jew. He's not an Orthodox. He's not a Messianic Jew. He's Orthodox Jew. And he's coming down from Atlanta. They say he's got a brain tumor and he's very sick. And they said they've rented a van, a handicapped van. They're bringing him down. So before he came to Pensacola, to Brownsville, he went into his doctor. His doctor was Jewish too. And he said to the doctor, he said, Doc, he said, I wonder if you'd let me take a trip. Doctor said, well, where do you want to go? He said, I want to go to Pensacola. He said, for what? He said, well, there's a church down there where they're having miracles. And he said, I wonder if you'd really... H-E-double-L, no. You're not going down there. You know better than that. You know you can't. You're not up for that. And the man said, Doc, am I dying? He said, yes, you are. He said... He said, well, what's it going to hurt if I go down there? Doctor leaned up. He said, well, let me tell you one thing right now. He said, if you go, you're on your own, buddy. Don't you blame me. I'm not releasing you to go. You're taking your own risk. So they put him in this van. They brought him down, and he was sick. His eyes were going crossways in his head like that, sideways. He was that drunk and dizzy with that brain tumor right in the middle of his brain. When you'd look at him, his eyes was vibrating to the side like that. He vomited all the way down from Atlanta. When I stuck my head in that van to greet him, they wanted me to go out there and just have a prayer that he'd be able to make it to the service. And he had vomited all the way down, and the vomit was just sloshing in the floorboard. That's how sick he was. They brought him in the sanctuary, and that night, Lindell started worshiping. And when he started worshiping, felt like the sun come out. Feel that heat, man. And you could feel it on the, you know, your neck and your hands and all. That man shot straight up out of his wheelchair. And he said, oh, my God, I'm healed. Like that, you know. And after seeing what I saw, I thought, probably is, yeah. You know. But anyway, he goes all the way back to Atlanta, walks in. They didn't push him in a wheelchair. He walks in. And the doctor said, what the hell? You know, H-E-double-L. Doctor said, what the H-E-L? And he said, what has happened to you, man? He said, you know, I told you I was going down there to Pensacola. He said, yeah. He said, I went. And he said, man, I don't have that brain tumor anymore. The doctor said, yes, you do. Now, don't you start that on me. Yes, you do. He said, you're in some kind of psychosomatic spell, man. Don't start that on me. He said, no, I'm not. He said, I'm healed. He said, look, don't worry about it. I want you to do an MRI. Don't worry about insurance. I'll pay cash for it. I want one now. And they did an MRI on him. The brain tumor was completely gone. Now, listen to this. Listen to this. He goes home back to Atlanta, and he goes to his synagogue, and he says to those Orthodox Jews, I got healed in Pensacola. They said, Pensacola what? He said, I don't know. I just got healed on there. They said, well, take us. And they leased a big old long bus and brought them down there to Pensacola. They came on a Sunday morning. They were all saved and baptized in the Holy Ghost. Somebody shout amen. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Do we serve an awesome God or what? Stand to your feet. Woo! What a mighty God we serve. Come on, church. Tony, you got that? What a mighty God we serve. I want to ask you something. How many of you like prayer tonight? I'd like to lay hands on as many as I possibly can. I know there's a lot of people here. But we're going to put on some worship music here for just a moment. We're going to put Lyndall on. And if you'd like to have prayer, and if you'd like for me to lay my hands on you, I'm nobody special. I'm being honest with you. All I am is basically somebody that God just happened to show up in his church, touched a lot of people. That does not make me special. And my laying hands on you is not anything special. Anybody can lay hands on you. But I'd like to lay my hands on you and pray for you if you'd like for me to do that. So what I'd like for you to do is, if you will, I want you to come forward. And as you come forward, we're just going to keep worshiping here for a few minutes, and I'm going to pray for as many as I possibly can. Okay? Here we go. Come on. Just worship as you come. I need a little bit of room to move around. Have you given it to him?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Hallelujah. Come on, while they're putting that on, everybody just lift your voice with me. Come on, everybody. Come on, just worship. I want you to get your mind off of who's around you. I want you to get your mind on the Holy Spirit.
Yes, Lord.
Jesus is passing by. Let God touch you tonight. Come on. Cut it up.
Yes, Lord.
That's good. That's good.
Yes, Lord.
Woo.
Oh.
Come on, lift your voice. Join in. I want everybody. Cooperate with the Holy Spirit. Come on. In this place, I want everybody to get your mind on the Lord. Come on, everybody, get your mind on the Lord. Focus. God's going to do powerful things here tonight.
Jesus, healer, say it. Say glory, glory, honor, honor, power, power, Jesus, Jesus. Say glory, glory, honor, power, Jesus. Let me know the kisses of your mouth. Let me feel your embrace. Let me smell the fragrance of your touch. Let me see your lovely face. Take me away. Even so, Lord, come. I love you. I love you more than life. I love you, Lord. I love you. My heart, my flesh yearn for you, Lord. To love you is all I can do. You have become my sole passion. Cause my love to be true. Let me know the kisses of your mouth. Let me feel your grace. Smell the fragrance of your touch.
Let me smell the fragrance of your
touch. See your lovely face. Take me away. Take me away. Even so, Lord. I love you, Lord. Sing to him. I love you, Lord. I love you more than life. I love you more than life. Come on, sing to him. Let me know the kisses of your mouth. Sing to the Lord. Let me know the kiss. Let me feel your embrace.
Let me feel your embrace.
Let me smell the fragrance of your touch.
Let me smell the fragrance of
your. Let me see your lovely face.
Let me see your lovely face.
Take me away with you. Take me away with you. Even so, Lord. Even so, Lord, come. I love you, Lord. I love you, Lord. I love you more than life. Lift up your voice to him and sing,
I love you, Lord.
I love you more than life. Yes, I do, Lord. I love you. I love you, Lord. I love you more than life. Come on, lift up your voice, church. Your arms,
draw me closer to you, Lord. Jesus, I love you. Hold me in your arms. You're the one that I adore. Oh, I love you, Jesus. Oh, I want you to hold me in your arms. Pull me closer to you, Lord. I want to be closer to you. Closer than I am right now, Lord. Oh, hold me in your arms. You're the one that I am. When the world outside seems so unkind, I find a resting place in you, a place that I can hide. You're more than breath, you're more than life, you're more than anything to me. Oh, hold me in your arms. Hold me closer to you. Closer to you, Jesus. Oh, hold me in your arms. You're the one that I adore. Oh, hold me in your arms. Pull me closer, Lord. Oh, to be close and hear your heartbeat, oh Lord.
Hold me in your arms. You're the one.
Feel the Spirit of the Lord here in a special way. In your arms is healing and rest for my soul. One word from your lips, O Lord, is deliverance to me. There's some people here tonight need to be delivered. Dearest friend, Lord Jesus, the lover of my soul, how much I love you, how much you mean to me, Lord. Hold me in your arms, Jesus.
Hold me close.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Mm-hmm. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. I don't know.
I need you. Kisses of your mouth. Let me feel your embrace. Let me smell the fragrance of your touch. Let me see your lovely face. Take me away. Even so, Lord, come. I love you, Lord. I love you more than life. I love you, Lord. I love you my heart, my flesh yearn for you, Lord, to love you is all I can do. You have become my soul passion,